gold. Tori Amos!
Tori reveals her discovery.
I finally realized that Lucifer is a woman, wears white, and drives an ice cream truck.
And he's been called the funniest man in England, Eddie Izzard.
Look, Colorado, this guy who's built his very own castle, Jim Bishop. And I have, for your viewing pleasure, Miss Tori Amos. Believe every time she performs. She has turned her personal traumas into 3 platinum albums, and her new release has already gone gold. Let's welcome Tori Amos. You look great. Thank you for being here.
Thanks for having me.
How are you doing today?
TV always makes me really nervous.
Oh, why?
It's not my thing. Because if I'm not behind a piano, then I just kind of... rabbit.
Well, yeah, I think a lot of performers are like that. Lily Tomlin was on yesterday. Or it was actually on today that they showed it.
Did she feel like that?
Yeah, but we were both talking about like how performers are so shy when you're not doing your thing and it's hard to... not have a character or a song or something to be behind.
I put everything in the music, really. I think all my different personalities, I sing about them. So when I'm doing this, people think that I'm really boring, so.
I don't think you're boring. Okay, you're a little boring.
Yeah, I know.
But how about like your, how about your incredible honesty and your,
well,
How about that?
It doesn't go over well, like at Thanksgiving dinner. You know, when things come up. I wrote this song called Father Lucifer, and my dad said, you know, I really resent that a bit. And I said...
because your dad's a minister, right?
Yeah. And I said, but, you know, that's the one song that isn't about you. And he said, well, what is it about? I said, well, I took this drug, ayahuasca, which is an... it's, you know, a drug from the Amazon. It's like an elixir, ayahuasca. And anyway, you know that movie?
What was that, like Prozac or?
I don't know. Honey.
It's like an herbal
Prozac
thing?
Is like Gerber baby food compared to this stuff. So what happened was, what I tried to tell my dad is, I really asked to meet the Prince of Darkness because I had had so many boys in my life that were kind of, you know, the kind where people say, guys would come up to me and say, why do you get those boys that are the bad kind? And I would try and live through them like they had some access to the shadow. And I was really trying to find my shadow side, which we all have. And you get so much power from
that. Are you on drugs now?
No, I'm not.
I want to go back because now I can't get off the... you've got to go back because you've got to... you got to be remedial with me, honey.
Let's go.
To know. What does that mean? Oh, so you went on like a spirit or a vision quest?
Yes, you do.
And like, so you figured out that you were attracting people to you because you couldn't face your own negative? Is that what you mean?
Because I didn't go in and really look at sides to myself, whether it was a side to me that can be the devious. And I would always
get the
was
guy.
Always, the other person was always sort of the bad one. I was always sort of the angel, and I really realized.
I so have done that in my life too.
I finally realized that Lucifer is a woman, wears white, and drives an ice cream truck. Rabbits.
Would that be bad then?
No bad about it. I think that, you know. My grandfather was part Cherokee, and he'd always say to me, who knows if he had a little smoke going. I don't know if he had a little smoke. But he would say to me, you know, the power that the Native people always had was that they really could go on vision quest.
Right.
And instead of, you know, finding it outside of yourself, you really are made up of many different personalities, and you honor that.
Right. People have a lot of different entities inside themselves, too. And now, word from our sponsor. And more with Tori when we come back. Serious for a moment, total change of pace here.
Okay.
You started the National Rape and Incest Hotline, which is pretty amazing. I want to know why you did that.
Well, it's called RAIN, mm-hmm. and it's a 1-800 number that you can call anywhere in the country. And what really happened was I was getting so many letters from women and men that had had this experience, violation in some kind of way. There was one particular night which really put us all over the edge, where there was a girl. She was brought backstage. She was hysterical. I finished the show, came back, and she said, I want to go with you. Anywhere, I just want to go. I'll work in the kitchens, anything. And I said, now how old are you? She said, I'm 14 and I can't go home. And I said, why can't you go home? And she said, because I was raped last night by my stepfather. I'll be raped tomorrow night and I'll be raped when I go home. I've been raped for 7 years. And so I called up Arthur, my manager, and I said, we're taking this girl. And then everybody gets on the phone with me and say, you're crossing state line and you'll be arrested for kidnapping. And I just said, you know, you're telling me I'm going to be arrested for kidnapping and we can't do anything about this. So that was really the pivotal thing that got us to get together with the D.C. Rape Crisis Center. And it's a team of people that really wanted to find a way to give people tools on how can I change my situation. So that's how it began.
And it's huge.
We had our 200,000th call, I think, just a few weeks ago.
That's such an awesome thing that you've done.
It's a good team.
Such an awesome thing. We have also because of you, we have three women here today who are all people who have overcome and survived some kind of violence of that nature, and we want to talk to you. We want to hear what you have to say to us. We have Karen, first of all. Karen, you're 43 years old. You're probably mad that I said that.
No,
but it says
I'm
it right here.
It.
Proud of it. That's cool. Will you tell us what happened to you?
3 years ago, I was coming home, and I parked my car in front of my house like I do every night, and a man came out of the bushes with a gun in his hand and kidnapped me at gunpoint from right in front of my home and took me to a second location where he had me take off my clothes in my own car and rape me for about an hour. At that point I saw, I was waiting for my moment to try to escape, and I had that opportunity when he got out of the car to relieve himself. So I grabbed my clothes and ran to the nearest house. And you know when you have a nightmare and you're dreaming and you're screaming and you think that nothing's going to come out? Well, I scream bloody murder, and I scream 911, I'm being raped, call the police, and I was banging on people's doors. Unfortunately, nobody opened their door to me. I thought I had finally gotten away from this man, and when he saw that no one was helping me, he chased me down the street and captured me again and took me to another location. Luckily, the people did call 911, but they refused to, three people heard me and they refused to open their doors. So he took me to another location, and the ordeal lasted for 5 more hours, so this was 6 hours altogether. And I realized that this time he said he was going to kill me, but he also, I mean, he was just really a crazy guy, and I knew he was crazy because he ran down the street brandishing a weapon in a residential neighborhood. So he just said, I'm going to kill you if you try that again. And I knew that I had to try something else. But first I had to decide that I wanted to survive. And I thought about, what do I know about rape? What do I know about rape? And one thing I knew is that rapists tend to dehumanize their victims.
Right.
So I decided I was going to become very human to him. And I was eventually able to talk him out of killing me and letting me go, because he said he was going to kill me up until the very last moment. So when the sun came up that morning, he finally allowed me to leave. And
I want to come back to you and talk about that. Just that what idea you had to make yourself human in his eyes to, and to live. We're going to get everybody's story first, though, and then we'll come back. Your name is Tara. You're 28.
Yes.
And you were molested by your now deceased step-grandfather?
Yes.
At age what?
7.
Will you tell us a little bit about it?
I stayed with an aunt, step-aunt, and he would always be at home, and she was gone to work, and I would come in from school, and he would do things that at 7, I guess back then you're not taught.
Right.
This is wrong, because what your parents teach you is not, this is not what my mom taught me, you know. And she
don't
told
they
me,
always t- also teach stranger. You that it's a stranger?
It's a stranger.
Don't get in strange cars.
Right. Don't sit on strange men's lap. Don't go home with a stranger after school.
No they don't one, tell your grandpa's strange,
or
though.
Grandpa or dad or mom or aunt or somebody, so I didn't know. And probably for about a year and a half, this went on. And after each ordeal with him, he would give me 50 cents, 75 cents, a dollar, send me outside to play until the next time. And he always gave me money afterwards.
It's kind of to enlist you in the whole making you think it's your fault. Huh?
That, and then as you grow older, I think what it tells you is that sex is for money. And you right. have, a prostitute mentality.
Yeah. We'll come back and ask you how you survived, too.
Okay.
And we want to hear from Debbie, who is 18. Debbie is not going to show her face in order to protect herself.
It was my 15th birthday, late summer, and a friend of mine invited me to go celebrate, have fun. It's a male friend. We went out just for a little while, and it got cold, so he's all, why don't we go back to my house, you know, we can hang out. Somewhere between leaving where we were and going to his house, we met up with 3 of his friends. And all 4 of these guys are my schoolmates, go to school with me. Went back to his house, 4 guys and me, and watching TV, eating, you know, just right. hanging out. My friend comes over, sits next to me, starts tickling me, wrestling with me, you know, just playing. And I'm like, okay, let's get off, it's enough now. At one point, he starts to get rough, and I start yelling at him. He pins my wrist down to the couch, and my back's to the couch, and I'm wriggling around. This guy's huge. All 4 of them are just huge guys. He proceeded to touch me and fondle me and kiss me, kiss my neck and say things, and the 3 other guys were just standing around watching and laughing and pointing. They ripped my clothes off, and my friend raped me. The other guys, in turn, all had their way with me. It went on for about 6 hours. By the second hour, I just couldn't move. I just felt paralyzed. I thought I was dead because I was screaming so loud I couldn't hear myself anymore. I thought that I was dead and that I didn't know where I was. I was numb.
Then you had to go back to school, right? See him every day? And
every day.
Nothing was done to him?
For a year and a half, I didn't tell a person. All I did for a year and a half was I wrote. I listened to Tori. I just wrote constantly and just wrote everything down. And I still have it. And finally, after a year and a half, things changed.
What changed?
I went to a friend, and she told me, you know, she kept asking me why I hadn't said anything, and you don't know until it's happened to you.
No, you don't.
You don't know until, you know, you're so afraid of what people are going to call you. People are going to call you a slut, a whore, just like those guys were calling me. They called right. me such terrible names. And I thought that's how people were going to see me if I came out about this.
Right. You went back to the school and gave a speech.
This happened a little later in May of 97. There was a rain day nationally, and radio stations and TV stations everywhere, during the scheduled programming, they aired abuse awareness commercials, and radio stations played Tori's song Silent all these years. And in correlation with that, then the very next day, I had my own rain day at school, at my high school. And I convinced the administrators to play 2 Tori songs an hour, Silent all these years, and another song called Mean a Gun, which is a beautiful a cappella song.
Right.
And They played this twice an hour, every hour throughout the whole day. I held workshops. And then during the day, I gave a speech in front of 2,500 kids. And while I was up there, I was smiling, and I was telling people stories about other men and women who had been abused and raped. And I could see those four guys in the audience. And I would look at them, and I was looking at them, and I just knew that I was hurting them more than they could ever hurt me by being up there and confronting them like that. And so that was so empowering and so gratifying. And that was a big step to my recovery.
I think they should continue talking. I want to know how you took it to the next step.
Yeah, go to the next level.
Well, the next step for me was in the emergency room. A friend of mine called the police, and I met them at the emergency room. Unfortunately, the police were extremely insensitive. You think things have changed in the last 20 years for women, but I...
This was in California.
This was here in California, and the police detective, she came into the room and put her finger in my face and said, "I want your friend, who I had with me to as support, out of here. You know, I don't want your friend in here." And I said, "Well, I don't want to talk to you unless my friend is here and there's a rape counselor here." And I kept insisting on that, and finally this female police detective backed down, but not until I insisted on that. It is now California state law that you are allowed to have a rape counselor and a friend as a support system in the room when you're talking about what happened to you.
And that's because of you, isn't it?
Well, I hope that I contributed to it, but it was a statewide movement to get that law changed.
For me, I just, as I grew older, and I didn't know that a lot of my acting out was as a result of being molested. And when I became 20, I began to volunteer for Rape Crisis Center, and I began to read the material, still not putting two and two together, promiscuous behavior, abusive relationships, and all this teenage mom. And I began to volunteer for this Rape Crisis Center, and I was reading the material, and I was like, wow, that's me, and that's me too, and that's me too. And all the feelings began to come out, and all the emotions. I joined support group. And I joined with some other women who is called AMAC, Adults Molested as Children, right, to deal with the issue, to deal with...
Because we really don't have, I mean, we think we're over this issue and everything.
No, you're
we
not.
We don't have any information about it almost at all to help our children, as to what to look for in children.
Mm-hmm.
Why is this information being kept from us?
Because I think of the myths that surround child molestation and incest. You think it's just a bad kid, a bad child. If a child doesn't want to go to an aunt or uncle's house, you may want to question that. If someone doesn't come out and say it stops here, then you're going to have a whole generation of this going on, men as well as women,
right,
as being molested. So I would think parents, educate your children and talk about the reality of child molestation, incest, rape.
On the other side, too, I feel like I want to say in the whole interest of, like, wholeness, that that people who are offenders, it's happened to them, too.
Majority of the time.
It's happened to them, too. Thank you all very much. Thank you.
Great.
You're all very brave. Thank you. Tori is going to perform a song off her latest CD when we come back. Performing Jackie's Strength from her new CD is Tori Amos.
He and Jackie, yeah, Jackie, yeah, Jackie. Jackie's strength, feeling old by 21, never thought my day would come. My bridesmaids getting late, I pray for Jackie's strength.
but I haven't seen Barbados, so I must get out.